And then we're trying to find the distance between
P and X.
So this is X right here.
Yeah, and this would be 175. And it would be tangent, since there's something on the hypotenuse. What do you think it means by nearest meter?
What the?
To nearest meter? That we're gonna round.
So like a whole number, I guess.
Okay. I think so, yeah.
32.
I believe that it's not just about solving the math, but it's also about being open to work with others and learn from others. Students not only learn from teacher, but also they learn from their peers. One of the ways that students learn is in social situations, so collaboration helps with that. It helps with critical thinking, which is what they're going to need to be successful in the real world.
Okay, so we're going to solve today triangles that are, we don't know the measure of a side or an angle. So I'm going to randomize you guys, put you guys into groups. Class Dojo, so look at the screen. Okay, once you see your group number, please go to the different groups. Once you see your group number, please go to the different groups.
We started at the beginning of the year with the transitions, working on the transitions, making sure that each time takes less and less time to get to the different groups. Once students see their groups on the board, quickly they should see what group they should go to. And we try to do it with under a minute. At the beginning of the year, it did take us a couple more minutes, but now we are under a minute, and so the transitions are pretty fast. They should have the problem already on the board so that when they go up to the board, the problem's already there. They're ready to work. The problem's already there for them to solve. They should start talking, and they should start solving the problem.
A surveyor needs to determine the distance across the pond shown in the accompanying diagram. She determines that the distance from position to position P on the south shore of the pond is 175 meters. You can draw it out.
Do I really have to draw it out? Because it's like...
It's already there, yeah.
Well, we do have to solve it, though.
What? Determine the distance between P to X, which is this?
Oh, so you just put an X there, X, no?
Maybe I should draw it out. Okay, boom.
And 91, yes. You could have, the reason that I need to check on histogram is because some students are going by fours.
Yeah.
So you're going to have more repetitive on that bar, or repeated values. So I don't let students go get the next problem. I go up to them once they raise their hand and give them the next problem. This is important for me because I'm able to see where the group is at if they were able to solve the problem successful. It's important for me to give them right away feedback. The colors are leveled by complexity. I use the colors of the rainbows. So we start with red and we go all the way to purple. 123, 125, 126, and 129. There's no middle value. Try to do it again. Try to cross them out so you can see. You notice that? Because it's an even number of data set, right? So when you have an even number, what do?
You divide by two. And divide by two. The algorithm and then divide by two.
Right.
But it'll still be 126.
They feel safe that they're working working on the problems, and that it's okay if we make mistakes. The whiteboards are very helpful with that. If they see a mistake or they caught somebody's mistake, they're able to just erase it right away, and it's not permanent. Research have said that groups of three are best. We have one using the marker, two collaborating and discussing, and so one of it doesn't just stand around and just doesn't work with the other group members. So three, it's the best.
For the lowercase, all you're looking for is like the opposite of this.
It says find B, so B would be right here, right?
Yeah. You're finding the side B.
I found that about around 30 to 40 minutes a good time for students to collaborate. If the time is too short, students don't have the time to go through the different levels and really try the harder problems, the more complex problems. If it's too long, students might be bored at the end.
Did I get the IQR or no?
Can I do it?
Yeah.
Wait, I kind of forgot how to
it's
do it.
It's a Q3 minus Q1.
Oh, okay. So 86 minus...
78.
78.
So now what's IQR? When the students are on the whiteboards and working on the problems, I'm more a facilitator. I'm going around to see where students are at and where they might have trouble. They know that I'm not going to give them a precise answer. I can help them to get to the answer they're stuck. Sometimes I don't even help them. I just say, can you look around and see if you can see somebody else's idea? And I'm more a facilitator trying to get the conversation going when I'm looking around the room. When I'm standing in the middle of the class and the students are working on the outside, I'm able to glance quickly and see where the students are at. So it is more manageable to see all the groups at once.
Wait, was that 156?
It's 150.
It's 150, uh-huh. Yeah, so you use sine. Sine is opposite over hypotenuse, so then that gives you 140.54. But the question is asking, to what height on the building will the ladder reach? So they're asking, what will be the height of the building?
140.
It's important for students to see problems being solved in different ways and not just one way. So I had that group that solved it that solved that problem in a different way share out. So the other students can learn, oh, there's not just one way to solve a problem, but there's multiple ways of solving the problem.
Three, and that gave you an angle of 27, right? Most of you guys use that. But this group used a different method. What did you guys use? So can you make a little drawing so that we could see, because we can't.
Can we draw this?
Yeah, put it on this side on the board. Because there's another way of solving this one.
So this angle is congruent to this one, because
you can show it on your picture too.
Oh yeah, on a transversal, these would be considered alternate interior angles. So we just set the angles; they'd be the same angle.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys remember alternate interior angles from last year? Yeah, two parallel lines cut by a transversal, and then that makes those alternate interior angles congruent. And then what trig function did you use?
Tangent.
They used tangent. And they use that 63 degrees instead of that 27 degrees, which is another way of doing this problem. All right, thank you guys. If I can have you guys go back to your seat and take out your... We do go up to the whiteboards at least twice a week. So it's a habit. It's become a habit. Now they understand that when we go to this class, oh, we're going to be collaborating. We're going to be talking to our peers. We're going to be solving problems together. And so now they're comfortable, they feel safe, they feel they love going into the whiteboards and working on the problems.
And that's the mean, right?
Yeah.